I've done some really nerdy things in my life. Like, I put a real laser in a Nintendo light gun. Here's when I recreated Lunar Lander with lasers and got an actual Apollo astronaut to play it at the Royal Albert Hall. And you've probably seen when I helped Tom Scott stop a laser beam in midair.
A laser bolt in midair.
Let me zoom in. Are you capturing this too? Yeah,
but when laser nerds and train nerds get together, it takes it to a whole different level.
It's playing asteroids!
If you want to find out what happened when I got together with Geoff Marshall from All the Stations, then stick around. If you haven't seen Geoff's video already, it's probably worth checking that out first, but here's where I'm going to be giving you some more background information on exactly how we did it, and of course those extra nerdy details.
It's a nerd heaven, isn't it?
Come join me.
First of all, let's look at how these kind of lasers work. Well, believe it or not, there's actually just one laser beam, and it's moving around so fast drawing all those shapes. There are two tiny mirrors inside, attached to galvanometers. One of them moves the laser left and right, and the other one moves it up and down. And it happens so quickly that it seems like a single coherent image. My laser code works out how to move the laser and when to turn it on and off in order to create all of these separate graphics. This project's a bit unusual in that I decided to carry all of the gear on my bicycle, so everything I needed had to be small and battery powered. The laser I'm using is called the Laser Cube by Wicked Lasers. It's a really impressive little unit, and it's got its own batteries inside, which is what makes it just perfect for this. It's also pretty powerful at 1 watt, and we'll talk about the safety aspect of that later. It costs around $500, so it is kind of a budget laser, and it doesn't have the fastest scanners, but it's just fine for what we need today. You can see the letters look sort of a bit childlike. The laser scanners aren't that great. And it's quite a lot of detail for this little laser to render all in one go. So it's like...
You tried doing a multi-line, didn't you? This is just a single line.
I did do a multi-line, but I would have needed two lasers for that. Okay. That look, that sort of childlike of writing.
Beautiful.
Like, that's not what it should look like. If you look on the Pi, you'll see what the font should actually look like.
This is the Pi, right?
That's the Pi, yeah. My code is fully compatible with the Raspberry Pi, and that's great in this case because it means I could just bring a USB power supply and run the lasers in a completely portable way.
Sorry, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm good.
No, I get a bit, like, trains excited and stuff.
You still get excited about trains?
Well...
Are you just, like, in a heightened state of activity?
You're
in video shooting mode.
Because I like being out, I like shooting, and I enjoy but the thing is that comes across, and that's what people like.
How can we not be excited about trains and lasers? Did you get it?
I didn't see it. Did it do it?
Yeah, it did it.
Did it do the twirly thing?
It did the twirly thing.
Oh, I missed it.
Oh, I got it. Don't worry. You can have my footage, Geoff.
What do you call a modern projector? What's that called?
A projector?
Projector. So they have like a keystone setting into it.
With the laser, because it stays in focus no matter what, you can really seriously undistort it. So that's why you'll notice the laser is off way at a side angle. Like, and I've done projects where the laser is like really close and pointing.
So what's the most severe angle? Could you have like 70, 80 degrees?
Oh, I could get it probably a couple of meters away from that wall. I did a project late last year in Barking. It's this manor house in Barking. I had to set up my lasers in the garden pointing at the building. Now the garden has got trees all the, throughout it. So I couldn't put the projectors any further away than like maybe 5 meters away from the wall.
And you adjusted it.
And I just, so it was at a really strong oblique angle.
Is that just a bit of code in your software?
You just a bit of code.
Just a bit of code.
Yeah, it is. It's actually a fairly well-known and solved problem.
Okay.
It's usually in sort of computer vision sort of techniques to do it.
If you were, I mean, you are a programmer, but you know, in the world of traditional programming, there's like GitHub and people have already sort of, like, say if you're doing, like, the most classic example I'm aware of is, like, if you're writing something to cope with time zones around the world, people have already done the code to cope with all the different time zones. Is there a bunch of sort of laser people that they've done some pre-laser code for you?
There's a little bit here and there, but projecting a laser, like, the vast majority of graphics code on the internet uses pixels.
Okay.
Right, so even unprojection, even that distortion fixing, usually that's designed to work on a bitmap.
Okay.
So to actually apply that to vectors, I mean, there is stuff out there, but it's just way harder to find. Yeah. Often it's old school geometry, like pen plotters and things like that.
It so reminds me of, wasn't it called Turtle Graphics on BBC Micro?
Yeah.
That was a pen plotting system, isn't it?
It's a classic vector graphics example, yeah. So we had a battery-powered laser, battery-powered computer, and now we also have a battery-powered smoke machine. In this case, it's a nicotine-free vape pen, and it seems to do the job.
What's happening now? Hang on, that's a joystick from an Atari 2600.
Correct.
Oh my God.
Set.
You're an 8-bit retro nerd too.
I hacked it. I've built a new circuit board in here. It's wireless.
What can I do with that?
Well, just hold that for me.
Well, I'm going to sanitise my hand first.
Oh yeah, damn it.
I feel like there's going to be a little coda at the end. But in our preamble talk about vector graphics and stuff, I was asking Seb about the game of Asteroids. And so you've given me we've just sanitised it, your Atari 2600 joystick, and you've set up a game of Asteroids.
Oh, I need to push this button.
It's playing Asteroids!
I'm afraid I haven't got the sound out of the Raspberry Pi because I didn't put in a sound card, but...
It's just the best thing ever.
You have to make the sounds yourself.
Oh no, that's Space Invaders.
Yeah.
What's your high score? I'm very competitive. I'm going to play now until I beat your high score.
Oh, it's 25,000.
Oh man, we'll be here all night.
I have no idea what my high score is.
How will we know what time the next train is, Seb, if I'm busy playing Asteroids? How will we know?
One thing at a time, Geoff. Are we going to need another laser?
I'm standing by the passageway of Aldrington Station playing Asteroids on your laser. Thank you, Seb. Awesome. From a safety point of view, this is a very low-powered laser, isn't it? This is not high-powered.
Yeah, so the laser is 1 watt, which actually is quite powerful.
Oh, but then don't say that. Let's do that again.
Yes, don't panic, Geoff. We've taken all the necessary precautions. Whenever you're using a laser in public, you really need to make sure you know what you're doing. I'd advise checking out the laws in your country and also getting some safety training. I'll add a link in the description to a brilliant UK course. And here we also have a guidance document made by Plaza, which outlines all the precautions you need to take. Even for this fairly small installation, we still produce documentation, a laser safety document, and also a risk assessment. So I really would recommend that you make sure to know what you're doing before you try anything like this. But for this setup, here are the main measures that we've taken. So the first step, make sure that the laser is fixed solidly, has a strong anchor point. I'm using a Manfrotto magic arm, which is capable of carrying weights way heavier than this little laser, so that's fine. There's a physical metal shutter on the laser, which we can raise up, so that should the laser beam stray lower than it's meant to, it'll get blocked physically. We also have software masking, but as any programmer knows, you shouldn't always rely on computers. But really, all of these are just redundant safety measures. Although the beam is very strong when it's static, when it's moving around very fast like this, the chances of retinal damage are very minimal. But of course, we still take all of these other safety precautions. You just can't be too careful with this kind of thing.
We've also got like a big red emergency button.
I mean, it's such overkill for this tiny little laser. I mean, oh, is that a train?
Oh, there's a train.
Is it?
What's your name? Hello, mate. You've done the tiles inside.
Yeah.
No way.
And the above and beyond bit.
You did this as well.
Yeah.
Are you just passing through as a local?
Well, I go through every day because I go to my allotment every day.
Can I talk to you on video?
Of course you can, yeah.
Come down into the light where it's
light. loving the smoke.
Oh, what's this?
So you can look.
Oh, Geoff, yes.
You can look my...
Yes, yes.
Yes.
We met the guy that painted the tunnel. What are the chances?
That's lucky.
There's people wandering by that don't even realise what we're doing. They think we're just hanging out. But everyone in Brighton is so nice. Everyone's just like evening.
Yeah. Wait, there goes by.
Trains are great, apart from when they're noisy.
Trains are sometimes not great, Geoff. Less great.
I mean, when they drown out you speaking, how do you feel it's gone?
Oh, it all worked, didn't it?
It
all worked fine. There was no problems.
Should more stations have laser displays?
That's probably... Yeah, okay, why not?
If Southern would like to get in touch with you at their stations that don't have them, like Winchelsea...
Yeah, let's just say yes.
Okay.
Let's just ignore all the major impracticalities involved with... setting up lasers in public places, and let's just say yes. But no, it did all work fine. Yeah, it looks quite cute, doesn't it?
Looks great.
Looks cute.
And
it's
look,
all good.
Look above your head.
Oh no!
Look behind you.
The train's coming.
Hey!
Oh, that's so cool.
Have you become slightly more interested in trains since we've been chatting?
This is quite embarrassing, but since I met you, I do find myself watching your videos and enjoying them. I still don't know why.
biggest compliment ever.
That's good, isn't it?
Subscribe.
Despite that somewhat backhanded compliment, I really do enjoy Geoff's channel. Definitely check it out. It's given me a really new appreciation for all things train. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please do like and subscribe to the channel, it really makes a difference. And as I post fairly infrequently, perhaps you wouldn't mind clicking on that bell just to make sure that you hear about it the next time I upload a video.